everyone, this is Kasia Bosne, and today I have a pleasure to interview rock star raw food chef Mathiew Kenny. I want to learn everything from him, what drives him every day to prepare these delicious gourmet vegan recipes for us, and what makes him one of the best raw food chefs in the world. Mathiew, thank you so much for doing this interview. I know you flew in this morning from LA. How are you?
I'm good.
Still alive.
A few hours difference, but had a busy day in New York.
I'm sure New York is super, super crazy busy. Mathiew, you became such a phenomenon in raw food, and you definitely make us think and feel different about the way how we prepare our meals every single day without deprivation. And I so much appreciate your delicious cuisine. I had a chance to try it many times. But foremost, I appreciate the precision that you put into designing every single dish. You put so much heart and soul into it that they often resemble Picasso's paintings. What drives you to do that?
Really, art, it's really art. You know, I look at everything we do as a work that should be, you know, reach its ultimate potential. And I think when I started preparing plant food as opposed to traditional cuisine, I started looking at it differently because it had something to prove. People would be questioning it. So I think what drives me is really the concept of just achieving its ultimate potential, because there's so much meaning behind it. It's nourishing people, it's providing health, it's food that's still alive.
That's fantastic. And how important is it for our health is to eat whole food, plant-based diet?
I think it's critical for optimum health. I think it's, I firmly believe it's the only way to achieve optimal health.
Eating meat, it's such a hot button. Just topic of eating in general, it's such an emotional, controversial subject. We are such a pleasure seekers that very often we get addicted to flavor and comfort food. And a lot of us think that eating vegan diet can be very boring. And when people ask me, what do I eat? What's my diet? And I'm joking. I'm saying that I eat a lot of grass because my diet is rich in sprouts. And I see that those answers create a lot of anxiety and a lot of stress. Why do we react this way?
Well, I think there are several issues that you just mentioned. First of all, we are pleasure seekers. Even our pets, they want food that tastes good. They always want treats or dog bones or whatever it is. So humans, of course, we're so evolved that we're going to want things that taste good and make us feel good. The issue, for, in my opinion, is the disconnect between what actually tastes good and is pleasure. There's addiction associated with a lot of traditional foods that are sold in supermarkets because of all the chemicals and because of all the sodium and the sugars. And it's created an addiction and an imbalance where people are completely out of touch with what actually tastes good. But the reality is, when your body's pure and cleansed, a fresh peach or an apricot, it tastes so sweet you almost can't eat it. So I feel like the first step is education. People need to understand what's happening and why that's happening to their body. But the second step is also to show that plant-based foods can be incredible. And, you know, the whole concept behind meat and us needing meat, I mean, I think that time will certainly tell the story, but for now, at least, it's pretty, the proof is in the pudding, per se. I mean, you know, that's why the people who have cured serious terminal illnesses naturally have done so by eliminating
animal proteins.
I've
seen it with my eyes.
And those who are living well into a much greater age are doing so by living on plants.
And like you mentioned, there is so much healthy food choice available out there. We get so much resources out there. We can really find out. It's really easy on the internet. There is absolutely everything. And almost every supermarket has its own department of organic section. And eating cheap or on the budget, it can be a blessing, but also can be a curse, because a lot of times those meals are missing a lot of nutritional value. And why is it then that we're getting sicker and sicker, and recent statistics are showing that one in every two Americans will get cancer? That's absolutely horrifying. Why are we ignoring all that health available to us and we choose to get sicker?
Well, it goes back to several issues. I mean, it goes back to, it maybe begins with addiction. It But it also it has to do with, you know, the lobbyists and the stream of, I'm a chef, so I come at it from the chef's perspective. I think chefs are at the higher echelon of food providers. You know, the biggest, if 10 of the biggest chefs in the world today, the most well-known chefs in the world today, those on television, those have the most well-known restaurants in Paris or the world number one restaurant in Copenhagen, whoever they may be, if they all really woke up and realized, and most of them already know that plants are a better way to go, but if they all actually just gave up their entire career and said, this is what I'm going to do the way I did, the whole world would change. So there will be a tipping point. I don't think it will take too long, but until then, unfortunately, a battle between addiction and big food companies and agriculture and lobbyists and so forth. But it is a little bit of a battleground at the moment.
So I'm happy that we are part of changing this movement and changing the world, hopefully.
Absolutely.
And especially when you live in New York City, in a crazy New York City that never sleeps, it's very easy to get tired, lethargic, low in energy. What would you say would be like 10 best habits that people can restore those energy?
I think, hydration is number one. I think of that because it's the first thing I do during the day and throughout the day. So proper hydration, it's incredible how many people don't drink water. Or if they do, they drink a half glass of water. Or even worse, they drink water when they're thirsty. Waiting until your body's dehydrated, yes. And you're eating only because of that. I mean, you're drinking water only because of being at that stage. That's a problem. I think incorporating, cleansing foods like green juices would be number one.
Right here.
Exactly. Cheers. Is super important. Replacing a lot of simple carbohydrates with whole foods. So a muffin or a bagel or something with an apple or a peach. I mean, I think you'd be shocked if you asked 10 people on the street when the last time was that they had a whole piece of fruit. It's quite incredible. Chewing food properly. It's so underrated, actually, because you can eat all the right foods, but if you don't chew your foods, if you don't masticate your foods, then you're not assimilating the nutrients, and your body's going to have to work three times as hard to digest them.
And if you eat them fast, like in the city.
Yeah. I have 10, I maybe have 100 habits, but food combining is really important.
Absolutely.
So if you're eating watermelon on top of, some heavy fats, that's going to be really hard on your body. I mean, I think to simplify what I'm trying to say is making things easier on your body, because the more you put unprocessed food or overly processed food or unmasticated food or poorly combined food or too much food or non-organic foods into your, any of these types of foods into your body, you're creating work for your body, and that's creating stress in the body and on the internal organs, and it's going to eventually create disease. And so preventing the opportunity for disease to be founded inside your body is really what optimal health is all about.
Absolutely. And you had a lot of training in a traditional classic French cuisine. How did you retrain yourself and shift it from cooking all the foie gras and using all the butter into raw food cuisine? And also, how did you start cooking? Why did you start cooking? Why not finance?
I moved to New York thinking I would go to law school, and I fell in love with the restaurant business. I just thought the pulse of New York City was really in the restaurants, and that's where I wanted to be. And I'm a little bit shy, so I thought it's a good way to connect with people and yet still be social. So I decided I wanted to open a restaurant, and somebody told me that if I wanted to be in the restaurant business, I should learn how to cook, because otherwise I'd be vulnerable to my chef. So I went to the French Culinary Institute, and I learned classical French cuisine. And I also learned that it made me gain 15 pounds in 6 months.
Wow. All that foie gras.
Just even handling it, I didn't feel good. And so when I graduated from there and started doing my own kind of cuisine, I didn't go to the total opposite extreme, but I eliminated the butter. I focused my cuisine more on olive oil and more seasonal, fruits and vegetables. But it wasn't vegetarian. It was just over time through practicing yoga and listening to my body and realizing what made me feel good that I that I realized that not only did plants make me feel better, but that I, as a chef, had the skills to make plants taste good and look good. So I had to rethink everything I had learned. But I was able to use the techniques, the knife skills, and knowing how to use equipment and knowing how to make food attractive. I was able to use all that, but the cooking techniques of reduction and sautéing and caramelization, all of that had to be just completely thrown away. And it was a lot of experimentation. It was many, many years of experimenting.
I'm sure it was. I first became acquainted with you when I attended Hippocrates Health Institute. I completed the health educator program there. I studied with Dr. Brian Clemons, who actually recommended your culinary academy. So I was on the mission to find someone who is the best and to learn mastering some good vegan recipes. And actually, I was also very passionate about developing raw chocolate, as I couldn't find anything on the market that pleased my palate. So it was no-brainer to me that I thought Matthew Kenny is the guy I have to study. I have to go meet him. So I flew this summer, this August, to your culinary academy in Santa Monica, and meeting you was just such a highlight of my trip. I did the intensive course of chocolate, and then I came to your graduation of your culinary academy students, and there were about like 16 of them, I believe, right? And what was the most amazing thing I observed, they were all from different countries, from different cultures, from different backgrounds, from speaking different languages. And they all incorporated that beautiful uniqueness that they had into creating signature dishes. And I think I've tried like about 30 of them, and they were absolutely out of this world that I wish like everybody could try it and eat it every day. And for people who are interested to pursue this passion, hobby, who would like to study with you, who would like to attend your culinary academy, how can they find you? Who can come and study with you?
Well, we've had students that are from 17 years old to 76 years old.
Wow.
They're from 40 or 50 countries. And we've designed our courses in a way that it's accessible to the whole world. And that's why we base them all on one-month programs, so that anybody can come on a tourist visa or a travel visa or a student visa, and also not have to give up 6 months of their life. They can take it in parcels. We also have located our schools in different, you know, parts of the world. So Miami will be really accessible for South America and the Northeast, whereas Santa Monica is more easily accessible from parts of Asia and Hawaii and the West Coast. Thailand will be closer to Australia and Asia as well. So and online, anybody can access it. So I think we're probably one of the, even though we're not the largest, we're one of the more accessible culinary institutes in the world.
Well, I certainly enjoy my time being there. And every chef has its own signature dish that it's very proud of. What is yours?
I guess for years it's been the heirloom tomato lasagna, and it's not because I think it's our best dish or our most creative dish, but it's because it was the first dish I created that I felt like, okay, now I understand this cuisine. I know how to go with it. Because the first 20 or 30 dishes I tried to make were boring, they weren't attractive, I wasn't happy with them. And this was the dish when I finally made it, I'm like, okay, there's the light bulb moment. I know this is a starting point, and it stood the test of time. It's still on all our menus. And I still enjoy it. Even after 10 or 12 years, I still like eating it. I would eat it for dinner tonight if somebody would make it for me. So
I wish I could make it for you.
I'll give you the recipe.
Well, it's not in this book.
It's not in the chocolate book. You can switch some things around. But that's probably the one, because it stood up for so long.
So I would like to know if there is any upcoming interesting projects that you plan on working in 2015.
Yes. Well, we'll be opening Miami, our culinary school, and our restaurant, The White Lotus. We're opening Datil in Limon in Merida, Mexico. We're opening Makeout, which is our fast casual concept in Culver City in California, and Plant Food and Wine in Venice, California. I have a memoir coming out in January called Cooked Raw, which will be a very provocative, fun story.
In which way provocative?
Well, I think it will push a lot of people to really consider their lifestyle and their food choices. And it's provocative because I come from a position of not being a vegetarian. The book, actually, I won't give it away, but it just it goes from one extreme to the other. And if I can make that change, anybody can. Because I grew up hunting and fishing and, well, I'm a classically trained chef and a hunter. I shot my first deer when I was 10 years old.
Wow.
So if I can make that change, nobody can tell me that they have to have meat. It's impossible.
But you didn't eat that deer, I hope. You
did. I did, yeah.
And you stuffed his torso on the wall.
And I did that too. So it was a big shift. Big shift physically, a big shift consciously. And I think it's important for people to understand how much change is possible and how they'll react to it.
Absolutely.
And we have quite a few other projects. We have a school opening in Thailand, many new classes online, and some product lines coming out, and three product lines coming out in Whole Foods, and a few others. So there's 2015 is going to be a pretty busy year. All the years have been lately, but I look forward to it.
That's fantastic. Matthew, thank you so much for spending time with me. I wish we could just jump to the kitchen now and cook something delicious.
Cook some lasagna.
Yes, exactly. But I have to hold my horses because I will be doing plenty of that in February as I sign up for your culinary academy in Miami that you just mentioned. And I believe in February that will be its grand opening, right?
Yes.
So I'm really looking forward to work with you, study with you, be mentored by you, master a few vegan recipes, and of course create the best chocolate, raw chocolate in the world. Your help.
It smells like you already have. I can see this raw chocolate.
Well, actually, I can smell this aroma totally. So
thank you.
So thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Thanks.